Rita Dove, thanks for letting us come visit.
My pleasure.
So what was your first reaction when someone said, take on this project?
Well, it was interesting because immediately I had this sense of what the 20th century would look like poetically, or at least I could see the outlines of it.
You did, and, right away.
Yeah, I just thought, what a great idea, the 20th century, not 2001, you know, but if we were to put this century in a time capsule and let its poets be the witnesses, I thought there is an arc, there is a trajectory. I wasn't sure quite how it was going to pan out, but I think it was that initial feeling that made me say, yes, I'd like to do this.
You said it as though there was then a second feeling, like, oh my goodness, what have I
well,
done?
Well, there were many second feelings of right. The feeling of, what have I gotten myself into? I mean, it's gigantic. And there were many a night when I woke up in the middle of the night thinking, who did I have in the 30s? Did I forget this? You know, just the mm-hmm. fear that I would overlook something very, very large and major, which I hope I haven't.
Were you intent on, and you've written about this, but intent on bringing in those voices that were not part of the canon, or perhaps not part of past anthologies?
It was not my overriding agenda, but I knew that was mm-hmm. going to happen, because one of the things that I've discovered through the years is that if you are not a mainstream person, in the sense of being of a mainstream, you know, gender or race, that you can tend to get ghettoized in the African American anthology or the Asian American anthology or the female anthology, and then everyone thinks, oh yeah, that's enough. Or yeah. if they are put into the anthologies, they're put in with something that represents their particular, what do we want to call it, their particular difference. Mm-hmm. And my experience has been, especially when I was going back and reading things, is that there are so many amazing poems by some of these writers which did not necessarily speak to that experience, but it spoke to the experience of being human, which is what it's all about. So it was exciting to discover that these poets, some of whom have not been in a major anthology before, had an incredible influence on their peers and on generations to come, and of course they go in.
Do you have a favorite moment in this anthology, or favorite poems, or little twists and turns that sort of tickle you that we might not see otherwise?
I think many people imagine that poetry is only about so-called high themes. Mm-hmm. And I love the fact that throughout history, actually, poets will choose something very small to write about. It, you know, may end up being about the high themes, mortality and everything. Mm-hmm. So one of the poems that I remember that this poem had quite an impact on a whole group of writers, literary people in the 70s. It was by William Matthews. And the poem is called In Memory of the Utah Stars. So it's about basketball, mm-hmm. kind of about basketball. But it begins...
But not a highfalutin thing, but basketball.
Basketball,
right?
You know. But it ends up... Because everything's about something highfalutin. But when he starts out, not where you think he would start out, but he says, each of them must have terrified his parents by being so big. You know, you think, what an amazing way to begin a poem. But then listen to this last stanza, which is just, I think, amazing. Something in you remembers every time the ball left your fingertips wrong, and nothing the ball can do in the air will change that. You watch it set, stupid moon, the way you watch yourself in a recurring dream. You never lose your touch or forget how taxed bodies go at the same pace they owe, how brutally well the universe works to be beautiful, how we metabolize loss as fast as we have to. To go from each of them must have terrified his parents by being so big to that ending, which I think encapsulates every former sports person, but every one of us. Mm-hmm. It's really amazing.
The potential and the loss. And
brilliant. And that stupid moon. I mean, I never see a basketball now. I think, stupid moon, you know, going for its target or not, you know.
You know, I can't help but notice that, because I went to the end, I wanted to see where you end.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't help but notice that it ends with a group of people, poets, that I happen to know. We featured a lot of them on the NewsHour: Sherman Alexie, A. E. Stallings, Elizabeth Alexander, Natasha Trethewey, Kevin Young, Terrence Hayes. A number of them are women. A number of them are African American. Is that where you see energy in poetry today?
It was so interesting when I began looking at the table of contents, the poems included, and trying to chart them, because only at the very end did I say, okay, let's see how this pans out in terms of women, in terms of nationalities. And I saw suddenly this incredible thing at the end of the book, where there are quite a few of people, as you say, are of come from different ethnicities. And I realized there is an incredible energy coming from that. Part of that is because I think through the century, different ethnicities have had a chance to get a piece of the pie and to begin to work their way into the, I guess you could say, the more intellectual levels of discourse in the country. And it's a reflection of that increased democratization that more women come in the second half of the anthology, and that more ethnic minorities begin to come in. That's part of it. But also there's a sense that the reins of literary power, I guess you could say, I don't know, that too begins to break
has
down.
Has opened up. You see a democratization in a sense of poetry.
Yes. I mean, poetry has, the access to poetry has gotten wider and deeper. And that gets reflected in the way, in the poets who then write about it.
All right, Rita Dove, thanks so much for talking to us.
Oh, you're welcome. It's my pleasure.